What's going on? My name's Robert, and you are watching Southpaw Auto Works. This video is all about the AFL valve. When there's problems with the AFL valve, it can result in a number of 4L60E problems, including smoked clutches, wrong gear starts, neutrals on highway, etc. Before we can identify problem areas within the AFL valve train, we must first learn how a healthy AFL valve train works. And that's exactly what we're gonna do in this video. AFL stands for Actuator Feed Limit. Another name for an actuator is a solenoid. So you could think of this valve train as the solenoid feed limit. As the name implies, the AFL valve is responsible for feeding solenoids a limited oil pressure. The modified fluid created by the AFL valve is referred to as AFL fluid. AFL fluid is fed to all the solenoids located on the valve body. Just for clarification, the TCC or torque converter clutch, the TCC solenoid is not fed AFL pressure. More on that in another video. This happens to be an early 4L60E that I'm using for demo purposes. All you need to know is that 93 to 94 models will not have a solenoid located in this section of the valve body, while 95 and on will have a solenoid installed here. In addition to the valve body solenoids, AFL fluid is also supplied to each of the shift valves. In a future video, I'll share how the shift solenoids and their respective shift valves work together to create both upshifts and downshifts. Be sure to subscribe and don't forget to hit that notification bell too, so you don't miss any of these upcoming videos. The AFL valve is fed line pressure. It's the highest hydraulic pressure within the 4L60E. Line pressure ranges anywhere from 55 PSI to over 300 PSI. The AFL valve takes that high line pressure and limits it to a max pressure of 115 PSI. In other words, the AFL valve feeds the solenoids a hydraulic pressure ranging anywhere from 55 PSI up to 115 PSI. In the next segment, we learn how the oil makes its way from the oil pan over to the AFL valve. When the engine is started, the 4L60E oil pump rotates at engine speed. While the pump rotates, it simultaneously sucks fluid in and pushes fluid out. The oil located in the oil pan is drawn through the oil filter and sucked into the pump. As the oil makes its way into this section of the pump, it becomes what is known as line pressure. As that oil pressure makes its way through a passageway through here, it exits through the screen. It then makes its way to the pressure regulator valve. The pressure regulator valve is responsible for regulating line pressure. The oil then makes its way towards the bottom of the pump. The oil exits the pump here and makes its way into the transmission case here. The oil then travels down this channel where it comes to a dead end, and the oil jumps through the separator plate and makes its way into this portion of the valve body. It travels across the valve body, once again goes through the separator plate and back down into the transmission case, and travels up where it once again goes through the separator plate and makes its way into the valve body and immediately encounters the AFL valve. Let's do a quick recap of the oil flow. Oil is drawn through the filter and sucked into the pump. At this point in the pump, the oil becomes pressurized and it becomes what is known as line pressure. That oil then makes its way through the pump, past the pressure regulator valve, which once again the PR valve is responsible for regulating line pressure. That oil passes the pressure regulator valve and makes its way down to the bottom of the pump. That line pressure goes from the pump over to the AFL valve. Now that we're all on the same page as to how the AFL valve is fed line pressure, let's learn how the AFL valve takes that high line pressure and regulates it down into AFL pressure. More on that in the next segment. The AFL valve train is comprised of a valve, a spring, a bore plug, and a retainer that keeps that bore plug held stationary. The valve has two forces acting on it. At one end, you have spring pressure, and at the other end, you have oil pressure. Naturally, with the engine off, there's no oil pressure acting on this end of the valve. And just so you know, this end of the valve where the oil acts upon it is called the reaction end of the valve. When the engine is fired up, the 4060E pump sends line pressure to the AFL valve. That pressure feeds the AFL circuit, which feeds both the solenoids and the shift valves. Oil also makes its way through an orifice and up to the reaction end of the valve. The orifice is used to stabilize the AFL valve. If we had no orifice in place, any of those pressure spikes, whether it's a spike up in pressure or a drop in pressure, any of those immediate changes in pressure would be felt by the AFL valve, and that valve would stroke violently in proportion to that pressure spike. This small hydraulic orifice is used in an attempt to stabilize the AFL valve as much as possible. With the engine idling and the transmission in park, the pump is going to output a line pressure of roughly 55 psi. That line pressure fills the AFL circuit and pressurizes it to roughly 55 psi. The oil located at the reaction end of the AFL valve is also roughly 55 psi. That 55 psi of AFL pressure works against the top of the valve ever so slightly, pushing it towards the spring. As line pressure increases, so does AFL pressure. And as that AFL pressure increases, the pressure working on the end of the valve, it also increases, pushing the valve downward even more. At roughly 115 psi of both line pressure and AFL pressure, the valve moves far enough to cut off the incoming line pressure. Now the AFL circuit is no longer being fed line pressure. However, that AFL pressure is bled off as the solenoids are continuously using up that AFL pressure. So with that said, the AFL pressure begins to fall. The pressure at the end of the valve also begins to fall, and now the spring starts to win, pushing the valve upward. The valve opens far enough where it now lets line pressure enter the AFL circuit, and AFL pressure starts building once again. And this cycle repeats itself over and over. Now that we've covered that basic diagram, let's take a look at what it looks like with the AFL valve in the valve body. When the engine is started, line pressure feeds the AFL circuit, filling it completely, including this L-shaped channel located at the reaction end of the AFL valve. You may be wondering how the oil actually makes its way into that L-shaped channel. Let me show you how. The oil makes its way through this portion of the AFL circuit. It then jumps through a large hole in the separator plate and makes its way down into the transmission case. The oil then jumps through the separator plate once again, this time going through the orifice. From here, the oil is able to make its way into that L-shaped channel. When the engine is started, line pressure is fed to the AFL circuit. Since there's no load on the 4060E at this point in time, line pressure is at its lowest value, which is roughly 55 psi. At this point in time, line pressure and AFL pressure are identical. So at this point in time, we have roughly 55 psi acting on the reaction end of the AFL valve, which has pushed the AFL valve downward ever so slightly. And as line pressure increases, AFL pressure will increase proportionally. So now we're at roughly 90 psi of both line pressure and AFL pressure, and we've got 90 psi working against the end of the valve. And the valve has therefore moved down even a little more. At roughly 115 psi of line pressure, the valve has now moved far enough where it cuts off the incoming line pressure. At this point, the valve buzzes, open and closed, really quickly. It's at this magic number of right around 115 psi of AFL pressure that the valve closes, cutting off its incoming supply of oil. So then the AFL pressure starts to drop because it's constantly being used by the solenoids. And as that AFL pressure drops, the valve is able to move upward with the assistance of the spring. But as soon as the valve opens again, line pressure starts filling the AFL circuit, raising the pressure again, and therefore the valve closes again. And this cycle repeats itself over and over again at a very fast rate. As even more load is placed on the 4060E, the line pressure climbs even higher. However, the AFL pressure is always going to be limited to roughly 115 psi. I really enjoyed putting this video together. On the surface, this video is about the 4L60E AFL valve. However, in my mind, I believe that it goes a lot deeper than that. When you learn how the AFL valve works, it puts you one step closer to fully understanding how the 4L60E transmission works as a whole. And when you're armed with that kind of knowledge, it'll enable you to make informed rebuilding decisions and diagnose transmission problems. I've got a lot more 4L60E videos currently in the works. Be sure to subscribe and hit that notification bell too, so you don't miss out. You can communicate with me by dropping me a line in the comment section down below. You can find more 4L60E videos that are already published in the video description down below as well. I would love to see more people get involved with this aspect of automotive. I believe that rebuilding an automatic transmission can be a great lesson in life. A lesson in dedication, a lesson in self-confidence, a lesson in belief. I am on a mission to bring you guys the best content online. And those aren't just some empty words. This video that you're watching right now has over 100 hours poured into it. For the time being, I personally handle every aspect of video production. After investing thousands of hours and dollars into this mission, I've come to a realization: hardly anything worth doing can be done alone. That being said, if you're interested in joining me on this mission, you can check out this video right here and learn more. Thank you so much for listening. Catch you next time.